Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. You may please be seated in God's presence. I would invite your attention to the book of Esther for this morning's meditation. This is something the Sunday school students are asked to go to their classes for the Sunday school. If the rest of us, those who are staying back, we welcome you to open your Bibles and look into the scripture. Esther, I'm going to do a quick overview of this book, and I hope to finish what we have started. I believe we'll be able to cover it. If it is not, then we will continue in the next week also. To begin with, I want to read a verse from chapter 4. Chapter 4, a very famous verse. Chapter 4, verse number 14. It reads this way, 14, 15, and 16. It reads this way, "For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place. But you and your father's family will perish. And who knows but that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this? Then Esther sent this reply to Mordecai, 'Go gather together all the Jews who are in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my attendants will fast as you do. When this is done, I will go to the king, even though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish.'" The story of Esther is a very fascinating one that we find in the Old Testament. One of the things that we need to understand is the historical background of the story so that we will get the message that the scripture is trying to teach us. This is after the Babylonian captivity. The Persians are ruling this particular group of Jews that are there in the capital city called Susa. Xerxes is the king of the Persian nation, and the nation is so vast that it had 127 provinces. We are talking about the time that is about 55 to 65 years after the Babylonian exile. And this is the story set in Persia. This is the story that is happening during the time of the king called Xerxes. And also chronologically, this is in the middle of between Ezra's time and also the building of the Jerusalem, dedication of the Jerusalem temple. So this is the historical setup of this story. And this king Xerxes was a very, very different kind of king. You know, we see him, somebody who indulges in so much of wine and drinking, somebody who wavers around so much in his decisions, somebody who leans on other people to make decisions, somebody who wants to show off his splendor to the people. This is a picture that we get about this person from this particular book. So what happens here is, this man who rules over 127 provinces that expands from almost Ethiopia to India. Two times the word India is used in this particular book. Two times, from the west to the east till the nation of India. This man is ruling. This man is around 450 BC. This man is ruling over this nation. And what happens is he announces 180 days of feast for all the princes and nobility of that 127 provinces, and he adds 7 more days, total 187 days of feast. Isn't it wonderful? I mean, 187 days of royal feast in the palace. You know, people are eating, their BP must have been up, their cholesterol must have gone high, their sugar level must have been erratic, everything is happening. And at the end of this 187 days, one night, he is standing there, this guy is having so many people around him, he is calling his queen Vashti to come into the presence of the king to show how beautiful she is. So a weird request to a very respectable woman. And what happens is this lady does not obey him. And this lady says, no, I'm not going to do that. And that very thing makes him so furious because his ego is hurt. And he says, I'm going to take you out of the position. You are no more the queen because you are creating a precedence for all the people, all the wives of this land, that they will never obey their husbands. And let it be an example for all the 127 provinces that I'm going to punish you. I'm going to remove you from the place of the queen. And she is removed. For what good reason? To indecently present her beauty in front of some people, those who were in their drinking, you know, erratic night. So that is what is happening. So this lady is out. And that is when he is asking for a queen and how to find a queen. They are bringing somebody suggested, let's have a nationwide search for it. They gathered some 400 young girls to be the next queen. And one of them was this Jewish orphan girl who was under the care of a man called Mordecai for several years because the father and mother passed away. She gets into this group of people and she happens to be in the harem waiting for the call of the king to be the queen and the wife. And this took 1 year of preparation for this, with this normal girl to be the noble, to be the person who can match the king's standard. Their beauty treatments are going on. There is so much of teaching that is going on. This lady is there for 12 months, 1 year. After 1 year, because of her nature, beauty, and also wisdom, she is being chosen as the queen of this king called Xerxes. So this is what is happening in the first three chapters. Suddenly, we see first two chapters. Suddenly, we see the other side of the story. A man is introduced called Haman. Haman is the second in line of leadership in the whole of Persian kingdom. And he is a rich man. He is also part of the high and the mighty. And he is standing there. Everybody is waiting. Everybody is giving respect to him. He is, by the way, son of somebody who comes in the line of Canaanite people. So he is a Canaanite. He's somebody who has issues with Jewish people. And suddenly, one day when he is elevated to that position, this man Mordecai, who was at the gate of the palace all the time, was not giving the due respect to this guy who is being elevated to this big position. So he was not bowing down. That hurt the ego of this Haman. He wanted to wipe out not only Mordecai, but the whole clan. Why I was prompted to read this portion, and I was waiting on God to speak to me personally and to the church in general, was this: that there is an impending annihilation, an impending genocide, an impending mass killing of a particular group of people because of certain people's ego that was hurt, and they felt afraid and scared, and they are plotting against wiping out people. And And you look around the world. You can look into our nation. Look into the nations of the world. Isn't it the same thing that is happening? A group of people, high and mighty, they want to tweak and they want to twist the low and the powerful in such a way that their vested interests will be happening in the nation. Not only in India, everywhere. So in such a time as this, the significance of this young orphan girl comes into prominence. I think we have some lessons to learn from this lady in this particular time. An impending genocide, an annihilation of Jews, that is to be stopped by this particular girl called Esther, who happens to be an orphan and also the queen by the providence of God. And this Haman is scheming and plotting against the people of Israel to kill them on a particular day. How did he choose the day? He threw the dice. Remember that, okay? He threw the dice with the help of his diviners and magicians. He threw the dice to get that particular day, particular moment. And they get to that place. This is the month that I should be I should be doing it. It is written in chapter number 3, verse number 7. And the Lord fell on the 12th month, the month of Adar. In the month of Adar, he is plotting that we are going to wipe out the whole clan of Jewish people. Okay, that's a plot. And another thing that happens meanwhile is this Mordecai comes to know about this particular plot to wipe out the whole of the nation of Israel. And he by the way, this man, Haman, goes to the king Xerxes with this request, and this king is not even asking anything, he grants it. He says, okay, go ahead and do it. Such people are there. You know, this they don't hear both sides of the story. They just hear one side and they say, okay, go ahead, kill. And they are about to do all these things. That is the right time when Mordecai acts. Mordecai calls Esther and speaks to her the verses that we have just read. And what he is trying to say to Esther is being told, you know what? If you choose to be silent at this time, relief and deliverance may come for the Jews from another place. You and your family will perish. God will do whatever he has to do. You and your family will perish. But maybe it is for this time that you have been brought to this position. So there is a lot to talk about. I want to I want to quickly come with me to learn certain things that God put in my heart so that it will be a blessing for each of us. One of the things that came to my mind when I was reading is this, that now is the time. Okay, now is the time. Everybody said, now is the time. You know, it is not tomorrow. It wasn't yesterday. It is now the time for acting on behalf of God. Hallelujah. Yesterday was not ours. Tomorrow it may not be ours. But today is given to us to make an imprint, make an influence, and also to stand for God. Today is the time to do that. I pray as we go through this chapter, as we go through this story, God will instill something new in your heart to do something for the kingdom, to do something for the people that are in injustice, to do something for people that are downtrodden, marginalized, and exploited, and being treated so wrongly in the power of the Almighty God. One of the interesting things that we need to understand from this book is that there is not even one time the word God is mentioned here. It is a Bible book. There has never been any time the word God is mentioned here. So that's when I was wondering, sometimes God is so silent in certain situations, right? God is so silent in certain situations, but it doesn't mean that he's absent. He may be silent, but he is not absent. He keeps working in us. Hallelujah. As we have sung, even though I don't feel you are working, even though I don't see you are working, I know you are working. Hallelujah. How many of you believe that he is working in us? He may not be working the way that I want to work. He may not be making it so loud when he works. He may not be making us understand so much when we work. But one thing is for sure, the Creator God is working in us and through us for his glory. Shout an amen if you're with me. The first thing I want you to learn is this. You know, God uses for his work in the world not just missionaries and ministers, but people out in secular space. He uses for his work both the lay and the clergy, and he makes everybody useful in the kingdom. Amen. We have made this distinction of clergy and the lay people, saying that these people are the people that are working, and these people are the recipient of the work, and the people that are seated there are going to be always the recipient of what the people on this podium are going to work. That distinction shouldn't be there. It wasn't there to begin with. Throughout the scriptures. If you see anybody that God uses, they were just normal people. Who is this lady? This lady is an orphan who happened to be in the land of Susa, in the land of Persia. She happened to be a queen in that place, in divine providence. But God uses her in her position. Jews are in that exile. You know, if you see that rebuilding part after the exile, we see Ezra being used. Who was Ezra? Ezra was a minister, a teacher of the word, maybe like a pastor. Nehemiah was a lay person, an urban planner and a developer. He was somebody who knew how to do things. Maybe somebody who is working with the government to develop a nation, develop a city. And Esther was a queen. So you need the pastor, the Bible teacher, you need the lay person, you need the women. We respective of the place that you are, in a profession that you are, God wants each of us to be used. Unlikely people from unlikely places becomes the pivotal part of God's purpose in the kingdom of God. Unlikely people in unlikely places become so seriously connected to the will of God and the plan of God. If you think of this Esther, she is the most unlikely person. She is an orphan. There is no father, no mother. She was under the care of this particular person called Mordecai, because he is related to him. She was taken care of by this particular person called Mordecai, and she comes to this place, and we don't see her as a person with the commitment of Daniel. Daniel was in Babylon. He decided, I will never touch the food that is offered to the idols. I will never touch the food of the king. I will be keeping myself holy. I will be so obedient to the law of the Lord, the dietary laws of the kingdom of Israel, the dietary laws of the law of Moses. I will never do all these things that are prohibited. I will keep myself clean. And then that cleanliness, that holiness was used of God to be a testimony. This woman is not like that. She's just a normal woman. She's just a normal woman. And in one of the verses that we see in chapter number 2, it says she pleased the head of the eunuch to get favor from him. And that's how she got into the palace so soon. No such ethics, no such commitment, no such huge claims of holiness, no such huge claims of upright nature in connection with those. He's just a normal person. Wants to live a life, and this came through, and she worked through somehow to get it. Are you getting what I'm trying to say? So this very lady, if you ask the rabbis, she will say, no, she is not the right one. If you ask the feminist, she will say, no, she is not the right one. She was like a pet for this guy who was taking care of the people there, and she made her way up with her hook and crook, she made her way into the palace, and this lady is not the right one. Let me tell you, it is most of the time, it is not because we are so right that he uses us, it is because he needs us that he uses us. Hallelujah. I just want to say thank you, Jesus, for using me personally, because it is not my moral uprightness, it is not the strength of my prayer or the strength of my holiness that makes me stand here to do what I am doing. Yes, I want to be the best person possible. Yes, I want to be the perfect example possible, but many a times I am not. It is the grace that enables me. It doesn't matter where you start. It doesn't matter how you start. It is the grace of God that is working in you, and he is using you. Can you shout a better amen? We are talking about the grace that is available for us. Hallelujah. He's not looking into your abilities. He's not looking into your, you know, it is not particularly your strength, your willpower to live in one particular way that makes you the man who can be used of God. It was your unworthiness that becomes the worthiness. It was your weakness that is becoming the strength. It was your forgetfulness, that nature that you have had that could be totally forgotten, that makes you the person to be remembered and used in the kingdom of God. I praise God for the grace that is available for each of us that make us worthy to stand for Jesus wherever he has placed us. A compromising woman, a woman of not very high qualities and commitment to the law of Moses, is used by God to turn the plight of the people around. That's where I hope you remember the three words that God spoke to us last Sunday. Love, feed, and follow. One more time. This is something that we should never forget. What is that? God is asking this church to do this year is to love God supremely, to take care of the people sacrificially, and follow him without any comparison. In that story, as I was speaking, one thing, I don't know whether you caught that he was talking to Simon Peter. Okay, Simon Peter. In chapter number 21, John is writing, after all these things, John is writing. He spoke to Simon Peter, that is his calling of Simon Peter. What John is calling Peter? Simon Peter. But what Jesus is calling Simon Peter? Simon, son of John. So do you see the difference? I want you to understand this. The difference is this, that the man who had to be the one who with a solid confession and a commitment, who was wavering like a reed, like Simon, become Petros, the Peter one, the one who has a solid confession, now lost everything. Now he is again as wavering as he has been in the Simon state. He looks into his eyes and calls him, "You Simon, son of John." But later on, the same Simon, son of John story is being repeated by his own friend who was loved by God. This man is asked whether you love me or not. This, the second person's love was proven, that everybody knew that God loved him so much, John, the apostle, the writer of the gospel. And he is writing again later on, saying that no. When Jesus asked him whether you love me or not, he was Simon, son of John. But now I know he is not Simon, son of John, because of the recommission and the reinstallation and restoration that happened on that seashore that morning. Now he is somebody who can be called as Simon Peter, the one who has a solid commitment. I like that word, Simon Peter. I think me, you, each one of us, we are the bringing or coming together of that wavering nature and the commitment of so strong commitment of Peter. Do you think that I am that? Some days we are Peter, solid. I am going to go. Sometimes we are favoring under the blanket, saying, that, well, should I get out of this place? You know, we are Simon. I think we are Simon Peters. God still wants to use us. We have that weakness following us. We have that pain following us. We have that baggage following us. But we have that moments of high spirituality and commitment that I say, Lord, I will do anything that you want me to do. I will go anywhere I want you to go. But God just forgets the Simon part of it and works the Peter part of it and uses it. I don't know how much you are thankful for that part. I praise God that he, in my weakness, found me faithful to represent him wherever he's asking me to be in. I'm so thankful. I'm so thankful. That's why I keep saying, if it was for me to choose a person to do what I'm doing, I would never have chosen myself. Because I know who I am. But God chooses. Hallelujah. Are you happy about it? Are you happy about it? If you're happy about it, shake the hand of the person sitting next to you and say that, Lord, this is so grace. This is grace that I am here. Hallelujah. Say it. This is grace that I am here. This is sheer grace that I am here. An unwanted man, an unwanted woman, an orphan who doesn't have much moral strength. Only thing that she has beauty, she has a little bit of wisdom, and she has loyalty to his uncle. That's what she has. That's what she has. But God says, I'm going to use her. I'm going to use her. Hallelujah. I'm going to use her. She is not Daniel. She's not David. She's not Moses. She is not great. She's just a normal person. Happened to be in a place of influence. Can you associate yourself with, I happen to be in this place. I'm just a normal person. Hallelujah. I happen to be in this place. I'm just a normal person. Hallelujah. That is the story of Esther. And now we see the impending annihilation that is coming upon the people of Israel because of the vile, wicked heart of Haman. And Mordecai comes to this lady and reminds him why you are there. Listen to this very carefully. Want your attention to be on that verse 14, chapter number 4, verse number 14. I want you to look at it. For if you remain silent at this time, if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place, but you and your father's family will perish. You know what? There is a dilemma. There is a paradoxical thing that happens in the very act of God using us. See, we are so essential for him. At the same time, we are not indispensable also. Can you marry these two things? It's very difficult sometimes. God needs you. God wants to use you. In that society, you are the only one for God. In that workplace, you are the only one for God. In this city, you are the only one for God. But if you're not there, God will have somebody else. Are you with me? So we are so essential for God. At the same time, we are not indispensable. We are essential, dispensable people. Are you with me? Who am I? I am so essential in the plan of God for Gurgaon. I believe I am so essential in the plan of God in the city of Delhi. I am so essential in the plan of God in the city or in the church GCLC. But I am not indispensable. It is just my honor and privilege to be part of the plan of God. And it totally depends upon my reading of time and making myself available for his use. Essential, dispensable people. Amen. Sometimes the moment we think that I am indispensable, you lost it. You lost it. We are not. We are not. It's a privilege for us. If God is allowing you to reach out, uncle is reaching out to the people around here. We saw the youngsters that are coming. Some of you are reaching out to your family members. Some of you are speaking to your co-workers. Some of you are representing Jesus in little ways that you can do. And let me tell you, you are not doing a service. It is a privilege that you get to represent Jesus. You are so essential there. But you are not indispensable. That's what he says. If you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place. You are essential. You are essential. You are needed there. There are certain people that only you can bring the gospel to. You are needed there. But if you are silent, relief will come from somewhere else. But what will happen? You will miss it. You will lose it. You will lose the opportunity. And your father's family will die. You will perish. That's what is happening. And then suddenly he says something else. And you and your father's family will perish. And then he says, and who knows that you have come to this royal position for such a time as this. Let me tell you, one of the things that happens with everybody, anybody here without any position in this world, in this life, you all have a position. Yes or no? Yes or no? Please speak back to me. You all have a position. Yes or no? You are a husband. You are a wife. You are a son. You are a manager. You are a pilot. You are a teacher. Whatever that God has placed you, you have a position. And one of the things that we need to understand is God placed you in that position with some privileges. Yes or no? Orphan girl. Had nothing, was living with this man called Mordecai, suddenly comes to the place of God's usefulness, and she has everything, and she has got so much privileges. But what happens is sometimes the privileges will blind us from the responsibilities. The more we focus on privileges, we will lose our sight from the responsibility. And I have seen so many people that are trapped in the blessings of God. I say it one more time. People that are trapped in the blessings of God. They prayed for the job. They prayed for the marriage. They prayed for children. They prayed for the business to increase. They prayed for more organizations to be planted. They prayed for more opportunity. And that very prayer's answer trapped him and lost the sight of God. Yes or no? Can it happen with us? You know, that's what, you know, oftentimes the greatest idol that we have are not the idols with hands and feet and head and all those things that people are. Sometimes the best idols that we have is what God has given us. This lady was picked up from nothingness, placed in that place of great honor and responsibility, and Mordecai is coming to tell her, you know what, you have so much of privilege, dear Esther, but I don't want you to be blinded of your responsibility as a Jewish girl in that prominent place. Can I tell you this? God has placed you in that place, in that workplace, in that society, for a divine plan. It was not to win bread and not just to win bread and live a life. It is for God's purpose that God has placed you. He could have placed you anywhere else, but for such a time as this, He marked your boundaries for Gurgaon to be in the capital city of India. It is for His kingdom and it is for His purpose. Shout a good amen and say out loud, I am available. Amen. Hallelujah. See, oftentimes we're so blinded by the privileges of the position that we have got that we forget the responsibilities. There are some Mordecais that come in between to tell us, don't lose your sight on the responsibility. Your primary identity is the Jew. You may be the wife of King Xerxes. You may be the queen of the land of Persia. But primarily, you are the descendant of Abraham. The same thing God is asking me to tell you that prime, you may be the manager, you may be the company owner, you may be the teacher, you may be the one who is running the whole show, but primarily you are the son of the living God representing the kingdom as an ambassador in that place. What are you doing there with that? If you don't do what you are supposed to do, salvation will keep happening. You will perish. That's what it is. you and your family will perish. That is what Mordecai's truth. Mordecai says, you know what? Salvation can come from anywhere. God wants to save somebody. It's your privilege to be in that same place, to share that gospel with that person, to tell him to come to church and receive Jesus Christ as personal Savior. It is your honor. It's your privilege. But if you choose not to do that, God will bring somebody else. You are essential, but not dispensable. You are an essential, dispensable person. You are not indispensable in this fact. It will be just a privilege for me, you to be in that place of honor, to introduce somebody to Jesus. Are you with me, church? So now, she is saying, maybe it is for such a time as this that you are placed there. By the way, God is not mentioned here at all. There is fasting happening, prayer happening, but God is not mentioned. Sometimes some commentators were saying, sometimes as if it was so much in the mind of the author that we will never mention God, that kind of writing. Because, you know, I'm not going to mention God at all. The thing is, that's what I want you to understand. You know, sometimes God is so absent. God is so silent in your stories, but doesn't mean that he's not working behind the scene. There are beautiful occasions that he keeps bringing that work into the forefront of the events that are unraveling in the story. But we will think, God, you are so silent, but you are still active. What happens here is, she says, okay, I'm going to go to the king's palace to meet him. But there is a problem. It's been 30 days that the king never called me. She has so many concubines and so on. And it is at the call of the king that the queen comes to the presence of the king. And there is a rule in the land that if anybody gets into the presence of the king without summoning, the king can just kill that person. Okay, that was the rule of the land. And she says, 30 days? It's been a month that this guy never remembered me. I don't know, the same story of Vashti is going to be repeated in my case. I don't know what is going to happen with my future, but now that you reminded me of my position and responsibility, I'm going to get into this place. I may be killed. If he stretches his golden scepter, then I know that he is happy with me. I'm going to go to the presence of the king. Let me tell you, every powerful position gives you an opportunity to do the responsibility of the kingdom. That is first thing. Secondly, that responsibility will always comes with some sort of risk. There is a risk involved. If you think that, let all those waves die down, then I will take my ship for a sail, you will keep sitting there on the shore. You will have to dare the wave for some time. Then only you will see the calmness of the deep sea. Nobody is going to airlift you and drop you in the deep sea. You will have to take your ship through the waves, and you will have to fight the waves to the rest of the sea. And I tell you, the rest is, how did the time go? The rest is, are you sleepy? Are you want to go back? Okay, come back next week, we will continue, okay? How is it happening? There is rest coming. There is rest coming to the nation. There is rest coming into this. But one of the things that we need to understand here is this, that God is asking for risk takers to bring that rest. Are you getting it? Sometimes the privilege that we enjoy doesn't allow us to take any risk. That's why we are not good with our responsibilities. that we don't want our nest to be disturbed, right? We don't want our ship to be shaken. We don't want the status quo to be disturbed. I want it to be right. I want it to go in the right sense. I don't want it to be, this is the way it has been. This is the way I want it to be. That's how we are most of the time. But God is telling, God needs the people, those who sense the time, that now is the time to act, to take risk. But I tell you, every risk is worth taking. The word witness, from that word only martyr comes. That means, if you really want to witness, you are risking to the extent of becoming somebody who lays your life for the cause that you're representing. Are you with me, church? Amen? Amen? So one of the things that I want to leave with you as I close in here is this, that God is telling us to remember your position and remember your responsibility. Amen? Once you remember your position and your responsibility, you should be able to take some risk for his name's sake. Maybe for such a time as this that you've been placed. And he uses everybody. Nobody in this place, in this house, can ever say that, no, I am not worthy. Because Esther wasn't so worthy. Esther wasn't Daniel. Esther wasn't David. Esther wasn't Isaiah, the great prophet. She was just a compromising young lady. But God was ready to use her. Amen. How many of you want to use it? You know, the second thing that God told us for this year is to feed the people. It is feeding outside. It's feeding inside. It is reaching out to people outside. It's reaching out to people inside. It is spending time with two people, one from inside, one from outside. We have laid out our plan for this year. We keep repeating it so that it will stuck to your mind and you keep doing it. And you are the one to do it. You are the one to do it. There is nowhere that you can say that I'm unworthy, because God is somebody who specializes in using the unworthy ones. Your unworthiness is your worthiness when it comes to his usefulness. Your inability is the ability when it comes to his usefulness. Your weakness is your strength when it comes to his usefulness. He uses you because you're weak. He uses you because you are unworthy. So only thing that we need to do is, as sons of Issachar, sense the time, right people at the right place will bring the right results. So sense the time. Am I in the right time at the right place to respond in the right way? And what is my response? Maybe it is for such a time as this that God has placed me here. Let me not blind myself with the allurement of the privileges and not see the responsibilities. And once I do that, I will take risk. I will walk into places saying this, if I perish, let me perish. But I tell you, when you perish and fall down, you're falling down into the arms of the Father. Amen? You will never perish because you have imperishable seed inside of you. Hallelujah. Are you ready to recommit ourselves? Close your eyes. Look to heaven one more time and just ask the Lord, Lord, I want you to move in. Hallelujah. I want you to move in my place. Hallelujah. I want you to cover me with your grace one more time. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Open your mouth and start praying. Everybody, open your mouth and ask the Lord God Almighty, Lord, use me in my place. How many of you sense that I am placed in certain places? Hallelujah. I am placed in certain places. Hallelujah. You have a position in your society. You have a position in your workplace. You are placed there for a bigger purpose. How many of you are saying that? You are placed for a bigger purpose. You can shun away, or you can stand bold. You can shun away, or you can take a stand. Once you take the stand, you know what will happen? you may find resistance, but there will be rest at the end. There will be rest at the end. Hallelujah. Maybe for such a time as this. Maybe for such a time as this, He has called you. Every eyes closed, every heart concentrated on Jesus. We're going to sing this song as the worship team leads us in this song. I want to give you an opportunity to respond. I want you on the second week of 2020, a new decade, a new year. You are making yourself available for God to be used in your own sphere. I tell you, we are essential people in the plan of God, but we are not indispensable. It is our privilege that God gets to use us, or we get to be used of God. And if you are that person who says, Lord, I am available for a greater usage in your kingdom, in the spheres that you have placed me, I want you to stand with us as a mark of commitment as we sing this song. Every person who says, Lord, I'm available.
Amazing grace that welcomes me, the kindness of mercy that bought with blood wholeheartedly my soul and deserving. God, you're so good. God, you're so good.
Say it.
God, you're so good. You're so good to me.
And I love Him so.
And I love him so.
Let the love of God fill our hearts. Let the love of God be more than the fear of risk. Let the love of God be more than our love for all our people around us.
God is so good. Somewhere working for my Lord, I'll be somewhere working. I'll be somewhere working for my Lord. I'll be somewhere working.
Lord, I pray that you will make ourselves available. We will be risk takers in the kingdom of God. Maybe for such a time as this that you're placed
in. When He calls me, I will answer. When he calls me, I will answer. When He calls me, I will answer. I'll be somewhere working for my Lord. Oh, I'll be somewhere working. I'll be somewhere working. sing for my Lord. I'll be somewhere working, I'll be somewhere working, I'll be somewhere working for my Lord.
Church, as you are standing, I believe that you are not standing because the person sitting next to you is standing. I believe that it was a personal commitment, a recommitting that is happening in your life to be the person who is available for God. The story of us, Esther, is a story of great escape of the people of the land of Israel. Impending annihilation. An impending genocide was overturned, reversed by the obedience and the availability of one orphan girl who happened to be in a position of influence. In the same manner, I believe each of us